and welcome to Zero Pucks Given, the UK ice hockey podcast. We are partnered with charity Blades Belong on Your Feet, fighting knife crime with ice skating, and sponsored by Ivory Tower Fitness, the premier private gym and personal training studio in Colchester. This is episode 30, and it's absolutely jam-packed. We've got results and news from Chelmsford Cobras, Pythons, and the Ice Hockey Academy. We've got a full debrief of the Hockey Hound Britain finals with the two fine gentlemen who provided the commentary on the live stream. A treat for both of them to call their own teams in the final. We'll find out how that went for them, discuss the result and the result of the national final yesterday, and get a debrief on the seasons of the Streatham Redhawks and the Solent Devils. I'm also joined by former Chelmsford alumni, now full GB international, currently out in Korea with the GB ladies side, Ellie Wakeling, and back home from GB under 18 duty in Serbia with a bronze medal round his neck, Chieftains fan favourite and undoubtedly GB18's number one, Luca Tessadri. First things first, let's get the results from the Chelmsford ladies and academy setup. Starting with the Cobras, the ladies had a double header at the Riverside on Sunday and it didn't quite go to plan. The Cobras still looking to be in the hunt for Sheffield, welcome the Kingston Diamonds, and it was a heavy defeat for the home side as the Diamonds ran out 14-5 winners. The second game of the day saw the Pythons host the Streatham Storm, a team who had previously beaten the Pythons 12-0. This time it was kept down to 2-0 and an outstanding performance from Kira Waddington in nets, facing 61 shots in the game. In the academy, the under-12s Mini Chieftains had a 9-1 victory at home to Haringey. The under-18s Mohawks visited the Spectrum in Guildford with 13 skaters and 2 netties and put in a stellar performance. Chelmsford took the lead on 16:37 through Harrison Prentice with apples to Bethel Higgins and Shelton. Into the second, and the Mohawks started to take control. Towards the end of the period, Prentice turned provider along with Brockbank assisting Ethan Rolfe on 35:29. And captain Chris Beckett made it 3 on 37:53, assisted by Metcalf. The third saw Chelmsford complete their victory when on 51:39 the Beckett brothers combined as George fed Chris for 4-0. And with 2 minutes remaining in the game, Reese King topped off the result, assisted by Harrison Prentice and George Beckett. A superb defensive performance from the young side as they restricted Guildford to just 14 shots, all shut out by Luke Conley. Final score at the Spectrum, Guildford 0, Mohawks 5. There have also been England selections for the age groups, another successful selection for the Chelmsford Ice Hockey Academy. The chosen few are under-13s girls, Lilith, under-13s boys, Rocco, Louie and Riley, under-15s girls, Cara, Kira and Connie, under-15s boys, Leon, Leo and Hayden, and under-16s boys, Alex, Eden, Luke and Joe. Congratulations, good luck to you all. Work hard and enjoy yourselves. Congratulations to everybody from the academy there. We are now going to get to our chat with the Streatham fan and the Solent fan that had the honour of calling the commentary on the live stream from the Britain finals. We've got Chris Beale from Streatham and Joe Scutts from Solent. Joining me on Zero Pucks Given now, we have Joe Scutts of NIHL Stats fame on Twitter. And we have Chris Beale, the Streatham fan, who was commentating on the live stream with Joe at the Britain final. Probably slightly happier last Monday than he is today. How you doing, gents?
Yeah, as you just said, slightly less happy than I was last weekend.
I'm over the moon compared to last weekend.
So, I mean, the way that you both got to the final last weekend was stark contrast, really. Streatham, fairly a tough game against Raiders, but they 6-2 in the end. So it looked a little easier than it was. And Solent obviously involved in just one of those games that the playoff semifinals tend to throw up every now and again.
I mean, yeah, I think we didn't say it on the air. I think we said it afterwards. But I think we're convinced either that second semifinal is jinxed, or Steve Osman is the jinx, because Steve Osman has been involved in both of those semi-finals and both of them have just been absolute barn burners with just crazy finishes. But yeah, I mean, like it looked like a routine win for us. We came in against Romford and just basically we did what we do against every team, which is basically just choked off the offense. And as Joe and I kept picking up on, they didn't deny us the middle of the ice, which Solway definitely picked up on yesterday, which is the biggest reason why we lost yesterday. Which, you know, if you're going to give us the middle of the ice, Vanya Antonov's going to punish you every single time.
Yeah. But I mean, for you, obviously, I was unable to hear it because I was at the venue with you guys, so it was. I feel like I missed out slightly there. But how was your heart in them last couple of minutes, Joe, in that semi final?
That was I mean, I've got enough stick for the fact that when Hauschka scored the third goal,
you called
I called it. I said, "Jura Hauschka puts the Dynamo through to the final." And my phone, like the amount of messages I got from mates from Solent and people who were just watching the stream just went, well, that's the kiss of death. It's like, yeah, no, I've managed to go the entire first season of doing this properly. And that was the first and only one I had the entire year. But it's one of the things, like, the Devils are weird. You know, it's heart attack hockey, it's finest. There was the game in Chelmsford last October with the Alex Murray goal at the buzzer.
Yeah.
Just descended to overtime. And it's one of those things, they've just sort of become that team that seems to get those games and finish up, like, get those games where it's like two goals in the final minute. And yeah, Chris can attest to this. I said to him, like, you're trying to call the end of the game stuff, and my heart is going a mile a minute. It was insane. And just, yeah, I think it took a lot out of them going into that Monday. That was the problem.
Yeah, it's bounced, isn't it? I think it's similar to Chelmsford last year, actually. You know, we alluded to the barnstorming game between Chelmsford and Bristol last year that had exactly the same finish. Bristol coming from 3-0 down to 3-3. But then, yeah, that does take a little bit out of you. I think Chelmsford were leading 2-0 in the final last year before,
before,
as you said perfectly, Streatham took control of the centre of the ice.
Yeah.
I mean, and pushed on to the win.
Scutsy will attest to the fact that I was the one having heart palpitations that afternoon when it was 2-0 down. He kept coming over to visit me from the Solent block and being like, calm down, you're going to do this, you're going to do it. And I wouldn't believe him. And of course, we ended up turning it around, but yeah, I mean, who we couldn't have predicted though that Hauschka, obviously, like the Hauschka incident would happen at the end of that semi final, which was obviously the big turning point. And I mean, the interesting thing was we said on the commentary, will Alex Murray pull the goalie? And obviously Scutsy said he's not likely to. And the next thing we know, Chico Cole is heading for the net, and Alex Murray has pulled this this cunning plan out of his hat to send out five forwards and one defenseman.
I think we said it on comms as well. I think there was that momentary bit of shock for the Dynamos where they saw five guys line up at centre ice on that draw, and you could almost see the panic of what do we do here? Who's our guy? Where have they gone? Kind of thing.
Yeah.
And that kind of gave them that, you know, momentary lapse which got them the second goal. And you just had that feeling where we're stood behind Alex Murray and I'm watching him write on the whiteboard, and he's basically just gone, we'll just do it again, lads, shall we? Might as well. It won't work twice, will it? Oh, yeah. It has.
Yeah. The definition of insanity, doing something several times over and expecting the same. Oh, we're getting the same result this time.
the Uri Hushka incident is something I've not actually really discussed on the podcast. I don't really know how it was up for discussion, what the outcome was, whether he was going to maybe walk through a guard of honour that weekend and left under a shadow. But it was call the incident how you guys saw it.
That was the problem. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, that's all right. It happened live and we were still commentating on a goal, and Chris was covering the highlight and saying what he saw, obviously. You know, the fact that he's the only one of the two of us that's actually, you know, played hockey to a semi-decent level and actually has that experience. Me, I'm just a loudmouth.
me too.
Yeah, exactly. It's the best kind. And the first we saw of it was when it came up on the clock. It's like, you know, Hauschka 5 minutes. And then, of course, I get it buzzed over to my phone what the actual call is. And it was only after the game where we went back and checked to see if we had anything for it. And we noticed that on the replay, you just see Hauschka launch his stick. We said this to Chris each other time. It's like a baseball swing. It's, you know, proper swing for the fences, home run job. And he's tried to, obviously, not clear the glass, but that's ended up what's happened. I think it was when we saw the reverse angle from the behind the goal afterwards, where it was, oh, no, that's even worse.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, at the time we didn't, we had no idea what was happening. We, as I said, I'm doing the analysis, we're watching the replay through, and then all of a sudden we look down and everything's kicking off down by the Dynamo's bench. Because
this was after we'd already dealt with Mitch Murray.
yes, that's what I thought. Like, we can't reference it on the air, obviously, but like there had been an incident with Mitch Murray up on that gantry as well. So I'm thinking Murray's somehow got down there towards the bench, and Hauske's stickers somehow ended up connecting with Murray from ice level. And then we found out later on, obviously, it was some poor unfortunate fan in the Raiders section who had been and his child who had been clobbered, unfortunately, by it.
Yeah, I think he's the young man whose son it was, as sort of said online, that Hauske came to apologize. He gave him his stick. He was very magnanimous and very, very sorry, and he's accepted that apology from him.
It's one of those things. I think, you know, we've all seen Jura Hauske play at this level for a number of years now, be it in an Invicta shirt, a Romford shirt, a Chelmsford shirt. It's the first time I've ever seen him do anything like that, ever. And it must have just been the fact that me and Chris said it after the fact. It was just that there must have been that sense of, how in the hell have we done that? Like, yeah, how have we just blown 3-1 in 58 seconds? And it's just, he's not that guy. And the fact that he went over and apologised, it's not surprising to me. I don't know if
No, it's not. He's one of the nice guys of hockey, isn't he?
Yeah, he really is he's a class act. And like, I mean, if you add in the fact that, you know, if it is true that that was his retirement game and he was going to go out with the Guard of Honour, or planning to go out with the Guard of Honour the next day in the final, obviously his emotion is going to be up at that point. Because he's just seen what he thought was the trip to the final tomorrow is now evaporating before their eyes. Mm. So you can kind of, I mean, not understand hitting a fan, obviously, but you can understand his frustration and why it was so out of character for him, really.
Yeah, probably the only rink in our league, especially, where that would have happened, because there's no netting in the middle of Milton Keynes, is there?
No.
Yeah, so it possibly would have been safer elsewhere, but
yeah,
not condoning baseball swings of hockey sticks into crowded areas. So into the final then. Joe, did you think it was all over after 35 seconds?
Not so much after 35 seconds. I thought we were in trouble when the second one went in. We said it both games that feature the Red Hawks in it. You know, to beat Streatham, you have to be perfect, which is something that Solway were at the weekend, something Solent weren't. And the fact that the first shift, you have that momentary brain fart from Chico, which is rarer than rocking horse excrement. Mm. And that leads to the easiest goal Streatham will score possibly all year. You kind of knew it was coming at that point. It's Streatham are a team where if you let them get on top of you, then they just beat you into submission. And of course, as soon as it's 2-0, it was just goals in bunches. It was that two in the first period. It's that two in, was it 15 seconds in the second, and it's 4-0. Yeah. At that point, it was just a case of, well, they can just shut this down and keep you at arm's length. There's nothing you can do about it. They don't need to score again. And it's one of those things, it's always going to be a case of what could have been. Me and Chris said it several times during the game, of Streatham's era of dominance just happens to have been at the same time that Solent had a golden age of players come through. And the fact that, you know, Streatham have, correct me if I'm wrong here, Chris, is it 6 titles, I think, in the last 3 years? League, double.
I can't count them now at this point.
League, six. There was one league.
That's not me trying to be arrogant. It's just I've completely forgotten.
I think it's 6. And the fact that Solent, all they've got for it is 5 straight runners up medals is for league titles. That goes back to the 2 in South 2 that lost. I think there is that sense of frustration of what, you know, could have been given another day, and if they'd started better on the Monday, you know, would have been different. You know, you can't give a team like Streatham a 2-goal lead and expect to catch up on it.
Sorry, Chris, I was going to say, for the second goal, something that I'm sure you see week in, week out, what Vanny did was just disgusting.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that some of the goals Vanya Antonov, like, scores should come with a parental warning. The way he cuts out of that corner and just roofs it. I mean, he's always, every time he cuts out that corner, if you let him cut out that corner, he's going to hurt you. And He'll either look for what we've done this year. We've had is Danny Inglesby and Ziggy Beasley will hang the net somewhere in that center area. And if Vanya can't find them, he'll just go for it himself. Mm. And that's the thing is like, I compared him at one point, and it got an interesting reaction from the fans. I was saying to him, I compared him to sort of like the Wayne Gretzky of NIHL 1 South at one point, because he loves that area behind, he loves being in Gretzky's office behind the net.
Yeah.
And he loves creating from there. And everyone seems to remember him more for his goal scoring. But if you look at his stats, like he generally tends to be more of an assist generator than a goal scorer.
Well, that second goal was the assist. I think he evaded Borchek three times.
Yeah.
And then fed Ben Painter, who finished brilliantly, top shelf.
Oh, no. That was, yeah, sorry. I'm getting.
That was it, Warman.
Yeah,
it was James Warman. Warman stepped in off the blue line and smashed it.
Yeah, we had it down as Painter, but.
Yeah, we did it. We did it on the broadcast as well. We were convinced it was Warman, and they announced it as Painter, and then it got corrected later. But I mean that's the umpteenth time now I've credited one of James Warman's goals to somebody else. I've done it several times on the Twitter updates with where I've just seen a flash of a three on the jersey and had to guess because the PA hasn't announced it quick enough in the rink and. Ended up giving it to James Warman, and it was actually scored by Josh Ely Newman.
But there was a, as I say, the game finished, I think it was 5-1, wasn't it, in the end?
Yeah.
And the Streatham crowd that were there enjoyed the celebrations. There was a larger Solent crowd there on the Monday than there was the Sunday, which was good to see. But I think it was still only a total of about sort of 450 people in a rink that holds 2,000. Do you think it's time for the two-legged final to return?
I think maybe potentially. I mean, the problem for our lot was basically everything out of London up to Milton Keynes trains wise was completely cancelled that weekend. Mm. So unless you were driving up or driving up and staying, you weren't going to be there.
Easter weekend for public transport does make it difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I was lamenting the fact that there was pretty much like we're in Milton Keynes for the weekend and there's absolutely nothing to do because nothing is open.
Yeah. Can confirm that he was whinging all day Sunday that he couldn't go anywhere.
Well, I wanted to go to the Sci-Fi Museum, but we didn't have time and it wasn't open. but yeah, I mean, it might be nice to see a return of the two-legger because it's nice to have that intensity over two nights, and it could have opened things up for more of a chance for Solent because they have that off first game against us, and then the next night there's the potential of the comeback on home ice, say for example, if the seedings work in their favour. I am inclined more to say that if there's only going to be about 450 people, we maybe need to look at moving it to somewhere. I mean, where in South you can move it to, but where move it somewhere smaller, like maybe the Romford rink. Mm.
Yeah, still relatively central, yeah. I suppose, isn't it? The Romford one to the South teams.
Yeah,
it'll never come to Chelmsford. Everyone hates us too much.
You'll never get 400 people in Solent.
No.
I think I've been to four of these now. I've been to two in the South, two when they were at the John Nike in Bracknell, and done the two in South, one at Milton Keynes, and. I like the idea of the playoff weekend. You know, you look at Coventry, you look at all at Nottingham, you look at all the photos and videos you've seen from the past week, and it's rammed and it's a real party atmosphere. Mm. And I've always felt in the four that I've been to, there just hasn't been that. It's always been that, the fan base of the four teams that are there are always there on day one. And then day two, if your team's not in the final, they don't turn up. I mean, I think on a Monday, I didn't see a single person from Oxford or Milton Keynes, like in a jersey. You could see everyone else there, Chelmsford, Invicta were to our left and right. You could see the Solent block was pretty full. Streatham's block was pretty full. The Invicta fans stayed off to our right. But then you're just looking around. Like you said, it's 400 people in a 2,500-seater rink. And I went to the Lightning Tigers game on a Saturday, and that place was rammed.
We stood
ringside. Chris was with his mates. And, that place was rocking when there was an atmosphere to it. And it always felt just a little bit flat over the weekend. And I know from the professional side of me has heard a rumour that apparently they are looking at getting rid of the playoff final weekends because they just haven't done the numbers that Coventry or Nottingham have done. And I think teams are more likely to want to go back to the two-legger thing. At least they can go with that and say they've tried to do finals weekends.
Yeah.
They just haven't really kicked on as much as they kind of hoped they would be.
I don't know if it's something to do perhaps with the sort of the cost of living stuff that's going on at the moment, because it's, I think the ticket is great value for a weekend of hockey. The ticket's incredibly good value. But it's getting everybody there, isn't it? You're pretty much from everywhere, unless Milton Keynes by some sort of stretch of miracle make it to the playoff finals. You've got to stay there really, because it's a pretty long way from everywhere. It's, you know, an hour and a half from Chelmsford, probably 2 hours up from Solent, and coming through London, like you say, if you're going to drive, it could take you up to five. So it's, but they're the two-legged final will give each team the opportunity to sell out their home rink and make a bit more money as well.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. And and as I said, also, you know, going back to it really it makes it less of a foregone conclusion, I think, because, you know, all we needed was one perfect game, you know, but playoff weekend two-game format, you need two perfect games to win it.
Yeah, or even to differentiate it from the cup, even a three-game series, if they could work out logistically how to do that.
I would love British hockey to do elimination series. Like with some of the rivalries you have in British hockey, I think that, you know, I don't know how well mine and Joe's hearts would hold up to it, but you know, I think a best of three, best of five between us and Solent, would be immense. Because I mean, Solent showed over the course of the last three seasons, even though they've always come up with the silver medal against us, like, they have had those one games where they end up just somehow pulling one out of the bag. I mean, those two nights where Chico Cole came into Streatham and stood on his head, you know, if he does that again in a multi-series playoff format, that's it. That gives Solent the gold medal.
Yeah, it's I think it's something that would really work. I think the fans would love it. I think the players would love it as well. I mean, we've had a 10-game series with Invicta. Unfortunately for us, we've had 8 defeats, 1 draw, 1 win. But they certainly have had our number this year. Yeah, and we were sick of the sight of each other come the end of the season.
I think I described it, to make a wrestling reference, I described you guys as the Zayn and Owens of NIHL 1 South. You were destined to do this forever.
Yeah, the living embodiment of fight forever.
Forever.
So, I mean, as a whole, then, I will sort of work our way up the table. I'm doing a full season review with Anthony Russell from Banners on the Wall next week. But as we've got you guys here, we may as well do your clubs now. So if we go for Solent in second, when I spoke to Alex before and after the games at the weekend, I remarked what an incredible season they've had. The performances, has actually been their away form that sparkled this year. How has the season gone in your eyes, Joe?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, I think I said in the playoff program that, you know, the Devils were basically road warriors all year. They lost 2 games on the road all season. One was on the high road just after Christmas, and the other was a game in Slough at the end of the season when Chico decided that a night at the UFC was more important. but the home form was obviously a bit of an issue, and I've always maintained the whole thing with the Devils. They've always needed that mix of players who are very fast with their hands for home games, but then they want those speed guys for road trips. And that's something they really had this year, especially when they brought in Ryan Sutton, Steve Osman later in the year. You could really tell that they were kicking on at the right time. I think if you look back in the hindsight of it, there was 2 weekends really which defined our season. And sadly, in both of them, we came out on the losing side of it. One was the Cup semi-final against Invicta, where for some reason or not, the Dynamos just had our name for the 2 games, and they came in to Solent and drew 5-5 and then did enough to beat us the Sunday, and then the weekend just gone in the playoffs. The 2 big moments, we maybe didn't show our best. There's been performances all through the year. I mean, there was a comeback against Slough early in the season where, again, dead and buried, came back and win it just before overtime. There's, you know, the second win on the high road in 3 years because Chico Cole does Chico Cole things. And It's one of those things. I'm going to be interested to see what happens going forward. I mean, I'll touch on it here. You know, you lose four big parts of that team in Chico Cole, Ben Locke, Jamie Fitzpatrick, Mark Pitts. And Muzz, I think, said it to you as well and said it to me. It's end of an era thing. They've got to try and rebuild it now. And I'll be interested to see what they do, who they go out and get, because I've always said to Chris and to other people whoever will listen to me, it's like Streatham will always be the best team in that league for this run. This run from 2019 to present day, they will be the best team in South One. They will have the best forwards in Vanya Antonov. They've had the best D-men in like Michael Farn, Leek Martelli, you can make a case for Sam Waller, but they never had the best netminder in this league.
No.
And it's one of those things, I don't care, that rivalries aside, be it Chelmsford, Invicta, Streatham, Milton Keynes, Oxford, whoever you want to name, Chico Cole was hands down the best netminder South One will ever see.
And I always agree with him on that.
And that's me being incredibly biased, but the numbers back it up. I had to do it for his... There's a post coming out at some point, if Alex ever posts it, where his career save percentage for the Devils was 920. Like, there are netminders in the world who'd kill to have a 920 save percentage for a year, let alone a 10-year career.
That's interesting. I mean, Luca Tessadri is on this episode later, so we'll see what he has to say about that.
I love Luca.
Luca's
one of the very few players this year who messaged the NIHL stats account to say both, thank you for everything you're doing. It's really good. Oh, and by the way, can you make sure the shot counts, you know, bumped up a little bit? So I, you know, it's got to look good on my elite prospects page, you know?
I love it. I get messages from his dad whenever he's played against us asking for the shot count, because for the exact same reason. But I mean, yeah, Luke, I mean, he came in at least once this season and absolutely frustrated our offense and got them. It was a bit of a dead rubber game because I think it was the one in the cup where we couldn't qualify at that point. But you know, pride still at stake at that point. And you know, you guys came in and played an absolutely perfect road game, and Luca was a big part of that. And I, as much as it frustrates me that he plays for somebody else, I absolutely love to watch him play. But I mean, going back to Chico, like, I will always agree with Joe, rivalry aside again, that Chico is the best netminder in this league and has been for the past three seasons. And he's been the reason why, whenever Solent have beaten us, he's been the reason why. He's just stood on his head. And I think it was summed up quite perfectly when Ryan Watt said to you the night before the final that Chico was the last goalie they wanted to see at the other end of the ice the next day.
Yeah. There's two games that will always stand out in my head. One is the first Streatham game in 2019 where he walks into that barn, stops 66 shots, and we walk out with a win. And I remember going over there, one of the Streatham players' mums just walks over to me and just says, oh, he's doing that again, is he? Yeah. And the other is, it's the game in Streatham from last season, which we won in a shootout, and he stopped 73 shots that night. And you just had that sense of, and again, much like Ben's just done now, they're just Chilson fans all around the roots, like, how?
Yeah.
He's
come to the Riverside and done it. He's done it to us at the Riverside as well. It's
you just had to stand there and just, like, some nights they were just like, how? I don't know how.
Because it's like our offense is like it's a multi-headed hydra. If, you know, if Vanya doesn't score, Danny's going to score. If Danny doesn't score, there's a chance Ziggy gets a dirty one on the doorstep. If Ziggy doesn't, Skokan gets one. The Ely Newman brothers, Ryan Watt, you know, cut off one head and two more scorers take their place. You know, and
it's embarrassment of riches he keeps going on about, Joe.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah,
I know. It's such a hard life he leaves in South London.
But so yeah, that's going to be a big, big man to replace down at Gosport. It's Chico Cole. There's obviously your reserve netminder was there, and Knight is also a perfectly capable netminder. But is the netminders like your Chico Coles, Luca Tessadri's? I'd probably go with Sonny Phillips as well. Another former.
Yeah.
Chance of thing, they're talisman in the crease, and they can win games on their own.
Yeah.
And it's something that's been said amongst Chelmsford fans to me as well, that everyone in the league respects how good Streatham are. But, and with no disrespect to Milts or to Annette or anything like that, they've all said if they had a Luca, a Sonny, or a Chico, they'd win everything. every season.
Oh yeah,
it'd be the Thanos snap argument.
Yeah, I mean, I've always said if I won the lottery, the first thing I'd be doing if I took over Streatham would be I'd fire the money cannon at Chico Cole.
It would have to be a big, big money cannon now. I think
it would be.
Work commitments have dragged him away for the week. But from we spoke on the Monday, Joe, you don't think it will be away permanently?
I don't know. I know from. I got a feeling that, you know, he was obviously really upset. The videos you've got and there's pictures doing rounds, you could see the emotion in his face that he knew he made the decision. And I like to think that there is enough young and up-and-coming netminders down at Solent nowadays that Chico won't exactly be a stranger there. He, you know, there's so much knowledge, there's so much skill and talent there that he could easily walk into just doing a coaching session every fortnight there and pass on enough talent that they'll learn more. That Tyler Campbell, Drew Campbell's son, is playing in, who was playing in the twos in the NHL 2 team this year. You know, he's one of those kids that could be phenomenally good in a few years' time. You know, our NHL 2 team was bobbins this year. And there were there's games he's walked in there and robbed teams. There's a game against Peterborough at home where he stopped like 55 shots and Peterborough finished fifth, I think, behind Invicta. And a game against the Fire as well, in Cardiff as well. So a long road trip and then you go and win with 11 skaters. It's one of those things. Chico will be he's a sad loss to the sport, but I hope he doesn't stay away for too long. Mm. You know, enjoy his holiday, come back and help out the kids a bit.
So, well, something that may affect both teams, because it's probably sort of equal distance between the two, that we haven't got Basingstoke Bison in the National League next year. So would their players keep their skates sharp in Streatham or in Solent perhaps for a season?
Well, I mean, they both have connections within both camps. I mean, I've heard rumours over the weekend in Coventry about a few Bison players that might be coming our way. And I mean, I've eyed up that roster. There's certainly a few players that I wouldn't mind seeing in a Streatham jersey. I could see some of the Bison players coming to us. It's all basically like, you know, who's willing to make that long journey from Hampshire up to us in Southwest London for training, for training, and then obviously the games on a Saturday or a Sunday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not the easiest place in London to get to. I mean, it's not quite Twickenham, but it's not the easiest place.
No, I was quite lucky. I used to live 5 minutes walk around the corner from the arena. But now I'm now living in Croydon. So it's a bit more difficult for, if you're a Hampshire-based hockey player to get here.
I'm Hampshire-based. I get a slough every week. Don't give me that nonsense. I've heard there's a few doing rounds. I know there's a couple potentially looking at Gosport. I know there's more than a few who are staying in the National League in a rink, like I said, that has a South One team in it that tried to go national. There's going to be loads of rumors. The problem is with Basingstoke nowadays, now for this year, is essentially it is just, you know, here teams come and feast at the all-you-can-eat buffet. Come take your pick of what you want and have them on loan for the year.
Yeah.
So I'll be interested to see how many want to stay at the national level and, you know, give it a year playing for a different team, or how many want to, you know, maybe a bit easier go down to South One and potentially go and run through another train with Streatham because they haven't won enough trophies in the last few years.
Well, hey, mate, thought.
Sorry,
go on, Chris. No, go on.
I was going to say, mate, like, you know, like I've said it on Twitter. I think like, it's like the plaques, they remind me of the Beskar ingots from The Mandalorian. So we've got to complete our suit of Mandalorian armour at some point.
And at some point as well, at some point we're going to have to sit here and just discuss Star Wars and Marvel and DC and not hockey, because I think we'd be here for longer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So at the start of your season, Chris, there's a few people that actually thought this might be the year that someone pips you. You had a few sort of players there. Obviously, Farney left. Malik went on a two-way to Milton Keynes, where he did get quite a fair bit of ice time. Ben Painter stepped up into your coaching role. But then you've had some real good quality youngsters come through as well this year.
Yeah, I mean, that's been the great thing this year to actually see, is because my criticism, especially during the Jeremy Cornish time, was we didn't have any depth. We had these very compacted but reasonably good quality rosters. But if anybody got hurt, you know, we would basically be down players. And during we kind of had that a little bit as well during the Farnie period. And then this year with Ben bringing on Oxen and Toombs and Maslak, and they have just they've really fit in really great. I mean, you know, you wouldn't expect Emil Oxen and Preston Toombs, like their first game. I think Oxen and created one of like the goal that sealed the game for Ben Painter in his first game, and Maslak got two goals a few weeks later again in that sellout home game against Invicta. You know, it's good to see that we've got like something in the pipe. I mean, as we said, like, you know, oh woe is us with our treasure chest
of talent,
treasure chest of riches, you know. But it's good to not have to when I do the team sheets before Twitter to go down it now and not have to worry about, oh, we're a bit short here and there. I don't know whether we, because you know, we had that early season blip where we lost over those 2 weeks, first to Solent, and then obviously we lost to you guys, and it was like, is it, and we weren't winning games the way that we, you know, we had the couple of seasons before. We weren't winning by by the ridiculous cricket scores. We were
NK Thunder.
Yeah. That's an exception to the rule. It did have me asking if you know, somebody was going to pip us, but then something just seemed to click in them after those two losses, and they just went on that ridiculous run towards the end of the season.
Yeah, I don't think you were defeated until after the title was confirmed.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, I believe.
Who did that out of interest?
Yeah,
that was at Chelmsford. But to be fair, I did actually note in that episode of the podcast in my match report, you were quite short benched, and I would imagine there was been some celebrations had.
Oh yeah,
but we did put you to the sword.
Yeah, but I mean, this is the thing though. As we say, like, you know, we've mentioned how Chico has obviously, you know, been responsible for, and Solent have obviously, you know, beaten us. But you know, you guys beat us 3-0 last season. I remember like last season, like, we started that season on a roll, and then we rolled into Chelmsford and you guys turned us over 3-0, and even that gave me pause for thought, because again, it was like this ridiculous offense that we have, and you guys just shut it down, you know. And I mean, I've always said, you know, Chico Cole is obviously the best netminder in the league. I think Sonny Phillips is like the next best behind Chico, and I think you know, he's probably going to be the biggest free agent coming into this off season in that goalie free agency market.
Yeah. I'm not sure. I have spoken very briefly with Sonny. He doesn't know what he's doing. We're not sure as to yet. We don't even know what Luca is doing as yet. There's possibilities of university. We don't know what Peter Cech is doing, although his new pads may suggest he's staying. He's had a new pad set with some black and gold in them. But like I say, it could be a bit of a merry-go-round this year with some of the players being available from the National. As Joe alluded to, I had heard somewhere that Slough were going to attempt that jump.
I know they tried it, and I know that despite tweets that you read and whatever posts that you might see, that it was never going to happen. Like, everyone will like to blame the bees for it, and the story doesn't fit what actually happened, if that makes sense.
Well, the thing as a whole, so when the NIHL announced that they've got their 10 teams for next year and that's locked in, that was kind of all put to bed. But I don't know if you guys agree or have another method on it, that the one and two need a reshuffle. 8 teams in our league and 13 in the one below is a massive discrepancy. There's no drama for playoffs in our league. There's at least 3 teams down there that could hack it in the one. And I think probably for their own good, MK Thunder should probably be dropped to the two.
I mean, Chris has had this discussion several times. You know, there's teams in NHL 2 that you could come up and, again, if you believe rumours, I think one of the ones I saw recently was that Lee Valley were meant to come up to South 1. And I've seen Haringey obviously show the ambition to want to come up to South 1. They'd be nice. And, you know, who wouldn't want to make 2 trips to Ali Pali?
Yeah, lovely. Yeah. Well, I'm sure when Lee Valley's finished, that'll be a nice trip.
Absolutely. I feel that hockey in this country is heading for something quite massive in just the terms of, again, it goes back to the whole cost of living thing, how much everything is at the moment, and just the way leagues higher up the pecking order are run. I mean, I'm not a fan of 15 imports in the Elite League. I said the ideal system would be 8-4-2-1. So 8 in the Elite League, 4 in the National, 2 in South 1, 1 in South 2. And because it just helps the Brits, you know, we should be helping Brits and come through. And, you know, the whole thing of the National League's roster limits for this year and, you know, allowing import goalies again. And, you know, the glass ceiling shrinks ever further. And I think, you know, with the Elite League, you know, you've always heard rumours of the Scottish teams want out and, you know, Solway want up into the National League. And if you can get something like Fife, Dundee, some of the SNL teams, the National League could be truly national, and then you'd have some of them drawn a drop down into a North and South. And I think once more, we're going to end up with in a few years' time, with just more merry-go-round circus of hockey clubs in different levels. And we're not going to get anything in the terms of, you know, forward momentum in terms of a GB swab producing talent.
No, I mean, I do agree with the import thing. I think they have upped it to 3, haven't they, for next year?
It's 3 in all leagues. It hasn't been announced yet. It's 3 in all leagues. It was a line in that National League thing, and that's since been confirmed.
Yeah, a few people didn't quite know how to read it, whether it just meant the National or it meant all leagues. And I took it that the roster limits were in the National, but the 3 imports and the import goalies was in all leagues.
Spoilers, roster limits are confirmed in all leagues as well.
Ah, interesting.
Ah, okay. Because that clashes with...
There are different regs to the National League, but I'm led to believe that there is going to be a roster limit in South 1 and South 2 and North 1 and North 2.
Okay.
So the import goalie one is a funny one for us, because we, as Chelmsford fans, possibly other UK hockey fans, I don't consider Peter Cech to be an import. He's lived and worked in this country for over 20 years. Yes, he wasn't trained here as an ice hockey goalie, but he could get a British passport if he wanted to. So the import goalie rule, I think, will possibly help Chelmsford if he stays, because we've got a Ukrainian lad in our setup who is legit, really looking forward to seeing more of him. Finished the season fantastically when Tessadri was keeping Cech on the pine. So it was... as much as it was to Sardar keeping Cech on the pine, it was also Sasha Maltsev playing that good that there was no point in playing Cech.
It's one of the things, in the summer, I help out with a cricket league down on the South Coast. And one of the things I've had to do this year is help out with registering overseas players. And it's just been interesting that one of the rules that the government have in terms of overseas players for club cricket is that if a person lives over here for a year and is here for, you know, 210 days, that player then counts as a Brit the next season. And it's with someone like Petr Cech or with like Drew Campbell on the South Coast, who has lived here for longer than they've lived in their home country, how can they not count as a Brit at this point?
Well, the National was going to had that rule a few seasons ago, and they seem to have abandoned it where they were. They were going to, like, if an import did 2 seasons over here, they would then be classed as a Brit a couple of seasons later. And then they've just abandoned it. But I mean, the interesting thing with that, I mean, obviously, as we said, like, we're going back to the merry-go-round with the goalies. It's like that import now that handshake agreement is gone again, that makes the goalie market at this level very, very interesting again, because who's going to be, you know, ejected from a national teams for an import goalie.
Yeah, so there could be more British ones available to step down.
Yeah, and just British players in general with the age limit things.
Yeah.
Yeah, if then roster limits do come in, then that's going to change. That will change a few teams' rosters, I'm sure. Yeah. But no, excellent. We're looking forward into next season then. Chris, we'll go with you. What do you see happening down at Streatham next year?
Well, hopefully, more of the same. It's all going to depend on who Ben manages to convince to come back from this season. Because I mean, I've already heard of a couple of elements of the roster that are departing elsewhere. But I mean, that you know, that's hockey. You know, you get to the end of the season, there's turnover. But I mean, the great thing about this roster is that it's a bit cliche, but they are like a band of brothers. They, you know, they stick together. They've stuck together through all this. And I think there'll be a large contingent in that locker room who view what happened on Sunday as, okay, this is unfinished business for us. We go again next year. We go for the league title, and, you know, we go to, you know, go to Coventry again, regardless of whether it's facing Solway or whoever, we go again. And that, I think they'll, you know, I mean, I can, off the top of my head, I can definitely say, like, I'd say Ryan Watt probably will definitely want to come back and have another go at it. It'll be interesting to see what happens in the net with Tom Annett's retiring. I'd love it if we could hopefully convince Danny Milton to stay and do a full-time gig for us, because he only played something like, I think, like, started 6 or 7 games for us this season. Joe, you're the stats man.
Seven in the regular season. He started the one game in the playoff quarterfinal, the semifinal, the final, and yesterday.
So
11 in total.
We just got that minimum requirement through for him. But yeah, it'll be interesting to see. I mean, if, like, the one I'm desperate for us to keep hold of, I had a lot of national level fans coming up and saying that Skokan bloke is quite handy. Like, if the fans have noticed, that means national level owners will probably have noticed.
Yeah.
So potentially Thomas will be probably getting some interest from the higher level. But, you know, I hope we can keep hold of him, because I still am flabbergasted we got him, just because if you look at his record, like, he's played Continental Cup hockey, he's played at the highest level in Poland. And when we signed him, I was like, what is this guy doing here? This guy is a national level import. I don't understand what
we said it on the comms for the weekend. He's played on teams with guys who've played in the elite league and put up numbers in the elite league. What's he doing in South Wales?
Yeah, what is he doing? Like, I have no idea what his reason for being here, but I'm happy he's with us, and I hope he stays with us next year.
So, Joe, it looks like a big rebuild for Solent next year, then.
It's going to be a big rebuild. You can't lose 4 guys who are integral to what the Devils were in one fell swoop. Steve Osman, I know. I would like to see him back. I don't think he will be, because obviously his connections to Bristol. And he basically only was a Devil because they messed up on the amount of games he'd played. But we'll take it. I think the big thing for the Devils, and I think it's something they've already worked on, is how many players from Basingstoke can they get in? You're not going to be able to get all of them, but can you get some that can, you know, contribute at this level? Because Alex Murray, for all of his, you know, eccentricities, is a phenomenal coach, and he uses systems very well. And once players buy into those systems, the Devils are a very difficult team to beat, as everyone can attest to nowadays.
Yeah.
The big thing is, obviously, you cannot possibly replace the man between the pipes. Mark Duffy, if he's back and if he's the starter, is basically staring at an unenviable job. It's a job that no one within a 300-mile radius of the South Coast would want to try and step in that shoes. I'd like to think that the Devils will be able to push Streatham again, or whoever, if it's Invicta, if it's Chelmsford, if it's Slough. I know for a fact that team will be willing to take on all comers. They'll welcome them down to Gosport, and they will try and send them back packing. And it shows the difference that from a decade ago, where Solent, if you saw them walk into your barn, it was an easy 2 points. You know, I've been doing the history start side of it, and, you know, you're looking at trips to Chelmsford where they're losing 12-0 and 11-0. And I made the mistake of the first away game I went to was in Streatham, and they lost 9-0. Thanks, guys. And Now they're going there, and they're now a team that people are scared of, and it's a testament to the amount of work Alex and others have put into that club over the last decade. So whether they can rebuild it from what it has been, I don't know. Can they do it? Yes.
Excellent, yeah. I don't think we'll be having as big a rebuild this year at Chelmsford as we had last year, because obviously we lost 5 through retirement last year, and then an extra 4 sort of going elsewhere. 2 of them did come back. Ethan Reid came back to us from Raiders. Matty Turner U-turned on his retirement.
I still have no idea how Ethan Reid couldn't like didn't get a fair crack of it at Romford. I'm sorry, like last year he was the most eye-catching player on the team that you didn't know beforehand. Mm. And the fact that, you know, a National League team basically decided, you know, yeah, after 20 games is ridiculous. I'd have him at the Bees in a heartbeat.
Yeah, he's actually in Australia at the moment.
All right, for some, isn't it?
Yeah. Holidaying, I hope, not playing out there, because they've just started out there, haven't they? But we've got Lewis Clifford coming in as head coach this year, so we could possibly see a little bit of Milton Keynes drifting down the M1 to Chelmsford. But
Alex White's available. I wonder where he's going.
I did hear he was available, yeah. Did follow me on social media the other day as well. I won't read anything into that. But so I'm really looking forward again to the next season. I know all the lads are looking forward to having a bit of a break throughout the summer. And look forward to how we go next year. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me. I am at some point going to go listen back to the stream and listen to your commentary, particularly of them last 90 seconds of the semi-final.
Yeah, I'd quite like to listen back to it as well, because I haven't seen a link or anything yet.
I was told that they were going to do highlights packages. I don't know where they've got to yet. So
I know it took them a while to come out last year. I think it was June before they came out last year.
I mean, we don't want to harass Tim, our cameraman, who was very much the unsung hero of our little trio that weekend. He did a brilliant job putting up with me and Joe in his ear all weekend.
But I know
producers everywhere need that.
Yeah, and was also brave enough to like try and get Mitch Murray out of the way when he was in front of like blocking the camera shot at one point as well.
I know they were showing highlights of last year's semi-finals during the the breaks and the periods and whatnot. And one of the Chelmsford fans shown me on the Monday that we were watching this yesterday, and then this highlight of this goal came up, and it was a Cam Bartlett goal in the Bristol game. And then the camera panned round to this goon in a white chieftain's jersey doing that. And I was like, oh, no.
It's like, oh, no, I'm here. Well, at least we know we've both done it now. You've got that clip. I'm going to have Hauschka sends them through to the final. I know. Chris, it's all down to you, Nick.
Next season, I've got to have the howler.
Yeah. Excellent. Gentlemen, thank you so much for your time. And I'm sure we'll bump into each other at some point next season.
Yep, no doubt.
Cheers, gents.
A huge thank you to Joe and Chris for joining me, talking about their teams. That was a really, really enjoyable chat. And it does sort of take a little bit off what me and Anthony will be doing next week with the review of the season. We don't have to do Solent and Streatham now. That's all done. So, but them boys, looking forward to next season. If you do see them at the rinks, do say hello. They're lovely, lovely chaps. Right then, our next guest is coming to us from Korea. I did have to do this twice, but the second time worked a charm. This is Ellie Wakeling.
It's a murder on the dance floor, but you better not kill the groom. Hey, hey, hey.
Live from Suwon in Korea, Ellie Wakeling, how are you doing today?
Yeah, I'm all good, thank you. How are you?
I'm really well. This may sound a little bit like deja vu for us. We did do this yesterday, but unfortunately it didn't record, so we're back again.
Yeah, hopefully.
So yesterday you played Kazakhstan in your second warm-up game. Unfortunately, it was a 3-1 defeat, wasn't it?
Yeah, but I don't think the score necessarily reflected how we played. I think, like the coaches said, it was more like a 1-1 game, really. Two goals that come from, but all three goals were goals that we could have done something different about. So for us, it's in a way that's a positive, knowing that if we adapt something small, the score might not be like that when we play them tomorrow. So yeah.
Your first opponents, aren't they, in the tournament?
Yeah, they are. So yeah, like as much as it was a loss, there was a lot of positives to take away from it.
And another positive to take from the first warm-up game where you beat Poland 6-2. I believe you were queen of the game.
The captain, Jody, chose that for that game. I gave it back out yesterday to Katie Henry. But yeah, it was nice to kind of get someone to see that you're putting effort in, doing your best kind of thing. So that's nice. But yeah.
Bit of recognition from your captain as well is always good.
Yeah, it was nice. And obviously as a team performance, it was such a good game. Like everyone did their bit. And obviously to beat the top ranked team 6-2 is great. Even though it's a warm-up game, it gives us a bit of a confidence boost going into the actual tournament. So that's nice.
Yeah. So you're a former Cobra, a former Tomahawk, a Mohawk. Right now you're a Raider, a Queen Bee, and a full GB international. Where did it all start for you?
At Chelmsford. So when I was four, I started playing, training to begin with, and then I started playing properly when I was five. So I had family down that were at the rink all the time. My dad played, my uncle played, my mum was a manager. And I was at the rink all the time with my mum doing her things. And I used to help tidy up the kit cupboard, little bits like that. And then one day Martin just was like, Ellie, you need to just get on. Like, you're here all the time looking at the kit. Just put it on and see what happens. So I did it. And here I am, however many years later. So
still going. And were you a natural skater?
I think I had skating because I'd done it from very little. I got put straight on the ice when I could. Wouldn't say I naturally knew how I wanted to kind of play hockey. I went from a player to a goalie, back to a player. But yeah, I think I finally, after having a go at goalie, trying to be a forward, I knew defence was like the place for me, really.
And with Raiders, of course, congratulations, you qualified for the playoffs, the Britain playoff finals this weekend. Unfortunately, lost in the semi-finals to Streatham, but put a great performance in.
Yeah, the team did really well. Obviously, I didn't play much of the games in the playoffs because obviously I had to think about GB. As much as that was frustrating for me, Bucky and Ben like made the best decision for me to be able to come here because obviously I missed the last GB trip due to getting injured like 2 days before. So yeah, but as a team, the team played really well. It was unfortunate to end up with Streatham, I think, in the semi-finals, but for what it was, the team did their best and yeah, kind of rounded off the season nicely for us to make that weekend.
Yeah, they there was a bit of fixture confusion coming into the playoff weekend. Obviously, Raiders upset the apple cart by being one of the lower seeds, beating one of the top seeds, beating Slough, of course, the third seed. And I did see you very briefly on the Saturday. But obviously, you wouldn't have even been able to play on the Sunday had you have made it because you flew straight out to Korea.
Yeah, obviously, the finals was at the same time as we had to meet at Heathrow. So, yeah, even if we made it into the final, I wouldn't have been able to be there. I'd have been able to watch on the stream whilst walking around through security and stuff. But, yeah, I wouldn't have been able to be there, unfortunately. So, yeah.
So you flew, obviously, straight out to Korea from Heathrow with your GB team. How's it all been since you got out there? The training rink looks lovely. They've set the change room up nice for you and your hotel doesn't look too bad.
Yeah, obviously, being one of the lower-ranked teams, don't get the best changing room. We've got, like, one shower between all of us.
Oh, really?
We're, like, sharing with Slovenia, like, if we, like, using their showers because they've only got one as well. So we've got stalls with, like, sofas as benches almost, but obviously you make do with what you've got. The rink's lovely. Someone said that they'd made it just really kind of, we're one of the first things to have happened in the rink, so that's nice. And the hotel's fine. It's quite a nice hotel. The staff are lovely. The food's all right. So, yeah, so far it's all been good. Been on the ice, had two training camps, I think about six or seven training sessions already, and obviously that's before the tournament even starts, so that's all been good.
Yeah, so you're all well in and well prepared. Korea as a country, are they particularly an ice hockey nation?
I don't really know. We played them at, I'm pretty sure we played them at the Olympic qualifiers. And obviously we're playing them now, but I've not really heard too much about different teams that are local or anything like that. But they're definitely a team that we'll have to compete with. I think they're ranked third in our division, so they can't be that bad.
No, I mean, over that side of the world, the Japanese are doing great things at women's level of ice hockey.
Yeah, definitely. So I think they're above us, aren't they?
Yeah, it's a sport that's great. They gave Canada quite a scare, I think, in the last Winter Olympics.
Yeah, good to see more countries getting that opportunity rather than just it always being Canada, America, Sweden. It's nice that other countries are starting to get themselves out for playing.
Absolutely, especially women as well, because it's, do you know what I mean? They're one of the in this country particularly, I think the women are progressing at a faster rate than the men. So it's really good that the other countries are joining in with that.
Yeah, definitely. Like you say, it's not women's hockey is a minority. Hockey in general is a popular sport in England compared to things like football, but women's hockey even less. So the fact that it's kind of getting out there a bit more is a really good thing for us, I think, especially for us in GB, is there's not really any publicity about it whatsoever at the moment. So the fact that we're working our way up the divisions now, I think will definitely help us with that.
Yeah, I think it's going to be the sort of thing that it's going to have to take an Olympic appearance to get it into the mainstream. If you look at what the Lionesses did with the football, girls playing football has just gone mad since last summer.
Definitely.
And I think if the GB ladies do make that next Olympics, I think it could have the same effect, almost like your own version of the Mighty Ducks. You could be doing it for the British girls.
It would be pretty. Obviously, it's all of us love to make the Olympics. It's one of my biggest like dreams is to go to the Olympics. Obviously, ever since starting to play hockey, it's something I've always wanted to do. So obviously, we'll have Olympic qualifiers again end of this year, beginning of next year, I think it is. So, yeah, hopefully from that, we might be able to make it.
Yeah, no, that would be fantastic if you do. So you've arrived out there with your teammates. Are you rooming with someone familiar?
Yeah, I'm with one of my best friends, Amy. She lives in America now, doing college hockey. So we don't see each other that often, but they room us together every year because they know it's like the only time we get to like spend together. Mm. So, yeah, I'm with one of my best mates, which is good.
And there's quite a raft of you that have come through the under-18s and under-16s and everything together, and you're now in the seniors. Is that sort of great for the team harmony? You've got that blend of youth and experience in there.
Yeah, definitely. We're a really close team and like a family. Like, it doesn't matter who you're spending time with. There's always conversation. You don't feel awkward. Like, you're happy to sit with anyone at the table. So that's good. Everyone spends different time with different people, can do different things. And like you say, we all know each other really well, and we now know each other on the ice even better. So it means that we've got a lot of chemistry throughout the team, which definitely helps with our performances, I think.
Yeah, it's good banter in the group.
Yes, definitely. We've got a microphone that we have with a karaoke on it that you might see on social media with Katie Marsden singing constantly. But yeah, it's good. The banter high, and we all get on, so that's nice.
Have you got a karaoke song?
My karaoke song of the tournament would probably be like Murder on the Dance Floor or something.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Do you want to give us a blast now?
No.
I also do a boxing podcast, and I was recording that with Robbie Davis Jr., British and Commonwealth champion, the other day, and we all very nearly broke into singing R. Kelly, which is, I'm not even sure how that came about. With your gear, obviously, I'm assuming when you started at four, you probably had to sort of just wear whatever was around. But since it's been your main sport, do you wear the same brand, the same style?
Pretty much Bauer, everything. I have CCM for elbows and leg pads, that's it.
Yeah. And have you ever had any help sort of sponsorship-wise with equipment?
My grandparents have helped me out massively. Obviously, my parents. My uncle has his own business, so that business has always kind of helped out too. I've been fortunate to have a couple of sponsors this season for sticks and skates, which has been a massive help because my skates were battered and I snapped like 3 sticks within a month, I think it was, and I never really snap any sticks, so that wasn't great. And obviously it is expensive, and we've been quite fortunate that this year Ice Hockey UK have helped us out with sticks for the tournament, so...
Oh, that's good. Yeah, it's good to get some help. It's something actually that I don't think a lot of people, until with a stick particularly, until you actually get one in your hands and sort of feel what they're made of and feel the bend and the flex in it. And then if you see one broken and see what's actually on the inside, because they're hollow.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people would be massively surprised to see one and then think, oh, like, I'm not sure, like, feel it and think that ain't going to break. And then when you actually see one broken, you think, Jesus, how does it stay in one piece?
Oh, the stick I've got for this tournament, we got them the first time when we got here. I was using it, the Nexus, and I can't even feel it in my hands. It's that light. And you just think, for something so light, it is so expensive. But it's just how it is. Yeah.
And how does it hit that puck at such a velocity without breaking every time?
Yeah, it makes no sense to me.
I've got some questions that have come from the Zero Pucks listeners. Obviously, you're still quite popular amongst Chelmsford fans, despite being in the navy and blue of the enemy at the moment. But I think you got a lot of respect when you came back to Chelmsford with the Raiders this year, from the fans particularly. Although Chris Beckett did board you, didn't he, into the boards?
Yeah, he felt very bad. I said to him, a heavy hit or anything. It's more me just not being ready for him falling a bit silly, but. Yeah, he apologised to me about 10 times for it. And I was like, Chris, I'm not hurt. I'm not sure. Don't worry about it.
Nah. And he got 5 minutes for it. So it's punishment due, I think.
Yeah, it gave us an advantage.
It did, yeah. Good close game that was. I think Raiders actually took in overtime, to my memory.
I think you might be right.
Mm. So I've got a question from Charlie. She has asked, what advice would you give to someone that's new to playing and your number one tip to improve?
New to playing, I'd say get as much ice time as you can. Go public skating, get your skating up. Skating's probably the biggest part of the game. If you can't skate, the rest of it's kind of useless. You need to be able to skate to get to a position to score, to defend, to do all of that stuff. So definitely go session skating, get as much ice as you can and enjoy it. I think I said to you yesterday, there's a lot of hours in hockey you spend. A whole weekend traveling, you spend your evenings at the rink. If you don't enjoy it, what's the point? So
exactly, sure. Yeah. And when you're traveling, there's a good hockey podcast you can listen to.
Well, yeah, exactly. Get on to
it. I had a question from Daisy Arben who asked, how old were you when you started playing? Did you pick it up quickly? But we did sort of cover that earlier, that at 4 years old, you sort of got into it and never looked back. So hope that's covered for that for you, Daisy. Scott has asked, what is it like being the only female player in the league and how tough is it being a female in a men's league?
It's good. I enjoy playing in that league. I enjoy the speed and the intensity of it. And obviously, as a defender, I feel like I have to use my brain a bit quicker, playing at that higher tempo. So for me, it has really improved my game. And helps me when I come away with GB and playing them tougher teams. I think I'm a bit more prepared because of that. Obviously, I'm quite lucky. I have a team who all respect me, who are all happy with me playing with them. Nobody really treats me any different. Got coaches that will play me with Ben and Bucky. And obviously, Lucas is now helping. So I've been quite fortunate with that. Obviously, it'd be nice to see some more girls playing in that league, but it just, like I said yesterday, it depends on what other people, other coaches see in their teams. But yeah, I've been quite respected as well with the other teams. Like they respect me enough to not kind of kill me, but to not let me have the puck at the same time. They'll still give me a bit of a bump along the boards or whatever. So yeah.
Yeah. I think the next generation is probably coming, actually. I've spoken to a few young ladies on this podcast. Lily Endicott, Abby Minter, Talia Davidson-Wright, who are probably going to, they're 16 now, so as they move up through their youth sort of parts in their female hockey, I would imagine we'll probably see some of them in the NIHL.
Yeah, definitely. There's a few of them, I think all three of them, Lily plays and Talia play Queen Bees where I play.
They do, yeah.
I've been on a line with Lily for a few games, which has been fun. Obviously there's quite a few girls playing NHL 2 as well, which is good.
There is, yeah.
So yeah, all of that's good, and like you say, the girls coming up are definitely talented players and all enjoy playing both women's and boys hockey, so hopefully they continue that when they're seniors too.
Absolutely. I don't actually have her name down in front of me, but there is a netminder at Bristol Pitbulls 2 who is fantastic. Female netminder.
I'm not sure who that is.
I haven't got her name down, but yeah, I've seen some of her stuff online. She's brilliant.
Yeah, there's some very good female goalies, that's for sure.
Do you think there's possibly a difference between being a female goalie and a male goalie, particularly perhaps with flexibility in the legs? Because when we watch Luca stretch it, it's impossible to think how a man can stretch his legs out like that into that sort of butterfly split position.
Yeah, I know what you mean. It's probably a scientific research behind it, but nothing I've ever kind of look into, but yeah, I guess it comes down to also like personal stuff. Like as a goalie, you've got to kind of practice your flexibility, things like that. So I think that all comes into play. But yeah, I guess there probably is a difference for both men and women of how they can do things like that. But I'll ask Luca. I'll get him to read that. Yeah.
Well, I'm not, as this won't be coming out obviously until the episode comes out, I'll actually be speaking to Luca later tonight. He's just arrived home from Serbia. So I will be briefly speaking to Luca.
Got a bronze medal now, hasn't he?
They have got a bronze medal. They did very well. I think Luca played most of the games, actually. I don't think he played the last one. But
Yeah,
fantastic performances.
I watched one of the games when before I come out, Luca was playing. He's had quite a good tournament from what I've heard. Obviously, I spoke to him a couple of times. So, one second, my doorbell's just going.
Have you got your room service?
Yeah. I want to talk.
I want to... There, we've got some GB teammates in the background there.
Sorry, I got made jump. It was someone being silly.
Proof that the banter is good.
Yeah, but back to what I was saying. I spoke to Luca a couple of times to see how he's getting on out there. Because obviously I've played juniors with him, and yeah, he said he's had a good tournament, so that's all good.
Yeah, he's getting a lot of recognition, particularly from sort of the higher echelons of the game as well. So it's something Chelsea fans have actually come to accept in the last couple of years, that enjoy him while we can, because he may not be ours forever. So
he'll be playing at a higher league, I think. I think he'll probably get a few coaches asking for him. He's a very good goalie.
Is indeed. I've got a question from Sophia Gatland, who's the Riverside's famous sign girl. What's your favourite chocolate bar?
I'd say probably Marvelous Creations. I quite like the popping
candy. Yeah, probably a bit of Cadbury's chocolate with popping candy, or I think they do like jelly beans in there as well, don't they, in them?
They do. Yeah, that's probably been my chocolate of choice if I had to pick one.
Yeah, if you can't find that, because they can be tough to find.
A Whisper Gold, I think.
Ooh, that's a really controversial choice.
Yeah, I quite like that. That would be.
Then I've got another question from, this come from social media. I don't know if it's a joint profile or it's one person, but Robin Elaine Potter, how does it feel to have a sibling in the GB setup with you?
It is cool. Obviously, it's nice to know that Brindley's doing well with his hockey and making GB. Like, I think I mentioned it yesterday. You can talk about the experiences you have, but unless you're actually going away with your teammates, you don't really understand it. Like, when you say, oh, I played golf in the corridors because we had 4 hours free time and we had nothing else to do, everyone looks at you a bit weirdly, like, why didn't you just do something simple? But when you understand it, because you understand the team dynamics, like the different things you can and can't do. So it's nice that we'll be able to speak with each other about like our experiences and like the countries we're visiting. But yeah, it is cool to say that we both play GB. Like, I guess it is cool.
An incredible sense of pride for your parents as well, I'm sure.
Yeah, exactly. I'm sure it's nice to be able to see both myself and my brother doing well with hockey, especially after the amount of hours they've put into kind of getting us to all the rinks, all the games. But Brindley's away next week with GB16, so hopefully, well, more this week I think it is, hopefully I'll be able to watch a few of the games around our schedule.
Yeah, have you two ever gone head to head?
Never. He's actually he trains with us at Raiders too, so we've had a few scrimmages, but we've never played against each other in an actual game. I don't want to, if I'm being honest.
Nah, do you think you'd smash him?
Probably make me look stupid with a toe drag or something. And he's 6'3", so his legs are double the size of mine.
Oh wow, really?
Yes.
It's funny, it's one of those sports actually that body wise there's not a perfect body shape or body size for an ice hockey player. It can be anything, as long as you've got that ability and that skating ability.
Yeah, you just
pull it off anyway.
You just got to have a good level of fitness, I think. and, like I say, practice a lot. And then it comes. But, yeah, you're right. Obviously, it can make a difference of things like speed and stuff like that, but everyone finds their own kind of way of doing things.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Brilliant. It gives balance to a roster as well, I suppose. If you've got a few big guys, a few small guys, it's with speed and power, it brings a lot of balance.
Yeah, everyone's got their strengths and weaknesses. So if you combine everyone's strengths together, you can probably make quite a solid team. So, yeah.
Excellent stuff. Well, Kazakhstan tomorrow then is the first game of the tournament.
Yep, 12:15 here, I think.
Yes, I think I'm going to find the YouTube link on the GB ice hockey pages and I will share that out for everyone. So if you're skipping off work in the middle of the day.
I'm going to watch. Well, it'll be 4:15 a.m. for you guys there, I think. So.
Oh, yeah, these times are all over the show, aren't they? It's
4:05 that would be. So, yeah, it is early, but honestly, like, the girls really appreciate all the support we're getting from home. Like, even now, just throughout the training camps, there's been really positive comments coming from home, which has been nice. And it is all getting recognised, so.
Yeah, no, that is fantastic. Yeah, and it's nearly 6 o'clock in the evening just out there in Suwon. Luckily, you can't see my bottom half. I'm still in my pyjamas. It's early morning here on a Sunday. So, Ellie, thank you so much for your time. Obviously, twice because we had our little mishap yesterday. But, yeah, really do appreciate your time and good luck for the rest of the tournament.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
A massive thank you to Ellie for joining me. Obviously, joining me twice. But, yeah, we got that done in the end. Girls are having a great time out in Korea. Since recording, they've actually beaten Kazakhstan 1-0 in their opening game. So, fantastic stuff for the GB ladies out there. Right then, our next guest. I know that you guys really, really do have a lot of time for this young man. He's just arrived home from Serbia, Luca Tessadri.
Back home, safe and sound from Serbia, Luca Tessadri. How you doing, fella?
I'm good. How are you, mate?
I'm really good. Thanks for joining me again. You're the first player to do a double appearance on Zero Pucks Given.
I had to come back. I enjoyed the first one. So, you know, get me back on the second one.
It was quite some while ago now, actually. I think it was early November.
Yeah, it was time ago, but we're back.
So congratulations on your bronze medal from the tournament. 4 wins from 5. And some great performances from you and many of the lads. How did it go for you?
You know what? We'll 100% take a bronze, considering from where we started, we had a warm-up game against Romania, and we lost that 4-1. So to pick up 3 wins from 5 and an overtime loss is, I think it's good going for us, if I'm being completely honest.
Yeah, and you sort of returned the favour to Romania, didn't you, after that first loss?
Yeah, we had to get revenge, you know. It was coming. We were feeling good in the room and, you know, a bad side, but they were a beatable side, which we could tell by our warm-up. In our warm-up game, we had to just adjust a few things and, we beat them in the end.
Excellent. So travel to Slovakia first for training camp and then on to Serbia. Was it decided in Slovakia who would be the starter? Because you did start most of the games. Or was it just between you and Alfie, both number ones?
In Slovakia, it was between me and Alfie. You know, we split the games 50-50. Like, it was said in Slovakia that it's all up for grabs. Like, anyone could take anyone's spot. And I guess as soon as we got to Serbia, finished the first training session. I got the heads up, I got the nod, and it just kind of went from there. You know, I started every game apart from the last one where, you know, it was good to see Alfie getting going. He deserved it. You know, I know it's tough being on the bench, right? But yeah, I'm so happy to see him in goal.
Yeah,
it was much fun.
Yeah, I mean, I can see there was a chance that they had on the power play where he made a phenomenal save, and your celebration from the bench was almost bigger than his.
I saw it on Twitter. I saw it. You see me banging on the glass and jumping up and down. No, I was I was proper happy for him.
Yeah, you're a special breed, though, aren't you, goalies? You're all cut from the same cloth.
Yeah, we all have to love each other. Can't hate on any goalies.
Nah. So your performances out there earned you quite a few plaudits online. You know, your name has been banded around quite a lot. And you're a firm favourite at the Chieftains. Your form was keeping check, riding the pine this year. You obviously know the importance of keeping your feet on the ground because you're a very level-headed young man. How do you manage that yourself?
It's just the way I've been brought up, you know. It's just like my dad always says, keep humble, keep respectful. And I guess, I don't know, I don't want to say I'm chilled out because I'm really not chilled out. I'm so active and so hyper. But as soon as it comes to, like, in hockey, that's where, you know, I have to cut out all this nonsense and do my job. And, yeah, that's pretty much it, you know. I have to do what's a part of the team and do my business, and hopefully the others do theirs.
Yeah. So the season just gone with the Chieftains. It's mid-table finish, cup finalists obviously as well. All on the back of a massive rebuild, multiple ins, multiple outs, and a change of coach mid-season. Could you break the season down for us, just from your point of view?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't... I won't be the first to say it, but it wasn't a great season from us. Obviously, it's tough when we have five guys retiring and we have to completely rebuild. And on paper, we were really good, but we just didn't have the greatest of seasons. And I mean, we can only apologise to the fans, and hopefully we'll be better next year. But it was a slow start. We got to the final, got momentum, and I mean, Invictus is the only team which we couldn't get past in the end. But
yeah,
that's just how hockey goes. It is how hockey goes.
Yeah, it was an incredible 10-game series against Invictus this year. I think they won 9 of the 10.
Thank God. I'm sick to death of playing them. I don't want to play them again. I've seen the jersey too many times. Just yeah, but it's out of 10 games, you know. I mean, don't get me wrong, we lost 9, but I've thoroughly enjoyed playing against them. It was tough, and it made us all work hard. And I mean, they are a good side. They won the cup for a reason. So
yeah, no, they certainly showed they were a good side. They were quite unlucky as well in the playoff semi final. That was the same sort of crazy stuff that happened in the Chelmsford Bristol semi final last year was happening in that. That Solent Invictus semi-final, so you can never call that happening. So what would you say has been the main ingredient in your progression? Because we discussed on your first appearance on Zero Pucks back in November, the fans took you straight away. You love a full barn and the raucous atmosphere. You really feed off of it. But in the last 18 months, you have just matured well beyond your years as a player and as a human being. So it's what's been the main ingredient behind that?
I don't know, maybe I feel old, don't get me wrong, I feel old. Like, I feel like I've been around for ages, but I don't know, I think, you know, I used to train with these boys when I was 14, 15, and I've kind of grew up in this environment anyway, so I've been around for a few years, and I think it's more just like, when you're young, it's like you're eager to get in there and get ready. And don't get me wrong, I'm still eager to get in there, but I think it's, because I've been around for, you know, with the team for a few years, you know, you kind of settle down and know where you're at, really.
So, and I think that's where my
progression has kind of shone through, because I know where I'm at.
Yeah. You had a great relationship with Sonny Phillips when he was at the Chieftains as well. Did you find that Peter was a really good influence for the sort of the mental side?
Yeah, I mean, he's. There's not much more you can say. He's a Champions League winner. Like, it is pretty sick. And to, you know, we've had conversations and one to one, and you learn from him. You do. You know, he's won more. So to learn off of him is pretty cool.
Yeah, no, he's and I'm assuming actually looking at his new pad set, he may well be coming back. So it's...
Oh, they do look good. But I mean, hopefully he comes back, but only time will tell.
So that was one thing actually watching the streams of the Great Britain games. It was quite easy to spot which of you was in goal because you pad set all black and Alfie pad set all white.
Yeah, that's well, that was probably the main difference. Is, yeah.
No, that's did have a good time sort of in general out there. Then obviously a lot of you lads would have played together throughout the age groups, so you all know each other quite well. And you had a couple of former Chelmsford Academy players out there with you, Sam Lyon, and of course Archie Salisbury has been with the Chieftains this year.
Yeah, I mean, some of the boys I played with, and most of them I played against with, and they're all phenomenal players. It is so good to play with. Even like 2006s, like they are seriously good, and they will. I'm sure they were, you know, do well next year. I don't know what the team will look like next year, but I'm sure they'll do just as fine, if not better.
Yeah. Is there another age group above the 18s before he gets to the seniors?
You got under 20s. Their tournament's in December time, I think, like early December time. So, you know, for me, it's I want that spot. But, you know, I do want to go away considering, you know, the 18s, that was so much fun. I'm sure the 20s would be a good laugh. And don't get me wrong, I'll try and I'll push to get that 20 spot. But that's only like a few months away.
Yeah, of course, yeah. I'd imagine there's probably a little bit more freedom with the 20s, maybe going out for a beer on a day off.
No, I don't know. hopefully, but, you know, it depends how it goes.
Yeah. How did you find Slovakia and Serbia then? Are they countries you've been to before?
I went to Slovakia. Like the place we played in, we played in there for England under 13s. So it was like, I guess it was a nice little throwback. You know, you go, I haven't been to that rink since I was 12 or something like that. So it was nice to be there. And I mean, Serbia is Serbia. Like, it is a nice place, but you could tell you're in Eastern Europe. You can.
Yeah.
But, you know, the people there are really nice. Like, we spoke to many of the Serbians, and like we had this tour guide which helped us around. Her name was Jackie. She was lovely. But all the Serbians are really nice.
And you did play and beat the host as well, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. That was a fun to play in. You know, I don't know if it's all live stream, but I don't know if they picked up that there was quite a bit of fans. There was, which I mean, only benefits me because I like playing in front of fans anyway.
Yeah, the way the stream was set up, it was you couldn't see any fans. It was showing the side of the rink that was bare, but you could certainly hear it, especially in that Serbia game.
It was proper loud, and like the way the rink is set out, like it is. Where you can't see the camera, like the stack of the fans, it was rows and rows and rows. It literally, like, the rows went on forever.
Really?
It was just all filled with Serbian fans. Yeah, so it was really good. And, you know, when you conceded, you certainly heard. You did hear.
Yeah, I think there was still a few good cheers when the GB managed to score as well. So it was, I wouldn't have said 50-50 crowd-wise, but you certainly had a few people shouting for you out there.
We did their bit, and I can, you know, I can thank my dad and my brother for coming out and supporting me, and even for people watching at home, we can only thank you.
Yeah, no, the support was great. Everything I saw online, and I shared everything I could find. That yeah, everyone was really, really pleased for the boys and the way they played. Obviously, getting the bronze medal. Was there any good banter? Any good stories going on from the hotel?
You could ban. To be fair, like the team, we were all as one. So you know, we all got along so well. But stories, I don't think it'll be very suitable for this.
No, not very broadcastable.
Not for the podcast. Not for the kids at home. But you know, like It was we were such a close group, and if like someone did something, everyone would get involved. And it was nice. It was good.
All right. Something I've been wanting to ask you recently, because I only really noticed it in the last few games of the season, that you and Peter play with your blocker and your glove in different hands. So yeah, what handed does that make you?
I'm right-handed. Like, I write and I kick with my right, but I just catch with my left, because that's just how I grew up with, I guess. It's just how you grow up with.
Really? Because do you think that makes it difficult, perhaps, for oppositions when you've got a goalkeeper, two goalkeepers that are different-handed, because obviously it's harder to score one side than it is the other?
It does throw you off a little bit. I know, like, in training, like, but achieve some boys, well, they used to get thrown off by it when he first joined, but I don't know if they get thrown off by it now, but it's just the way you grow up and you learn to play hockey. It's the first person I've seen in person who does play the opposite hands.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it was just something I noticed, and I thought it must be quite difficult for a forward player, if you're coming up with the puck and you're seeing a netminder that's got his stick and his blocker in one certain position, and then obviously if you get one that's the other handed, it's all the other way around. So it's,
yeah, I mean, some people just constantly shoot glove, and they know their spot to shoot, and that just blocks it, I guess. But it's the same as for the other way. If you constantly shoot blocker and Pat has this massive glove and it's just going in there, you've got to find a different way to score.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, it's your job to keep them all out.
Yeah, of course. We try our best. We do.
So you're done with hockey now for this season? You got yourself a bit of time off?
Yeah, I've got time off. Well, I say time off, I'll probably train throughout summer and you know, I want to relax a bit. You know, I've got exams in that coming up. So, but by the time that's done, I'll be getting back to training and hopefully sorting myself out for next year and, you know, getting back in the goal and hopefully saving some more pucks.
Absolutely, mate. Well, all the best for your summer. You certainly deserve a break and a bit of relaxation. And when we find out whatever you're doing next year, make sure you come and tell us.
No, of course. Thank you very much, mate. Thank you.
You're a good man. Thanks for coming on. Congratulations on your bronze, mate. And hopefully see you next week at the end of season presentation.
Yeah, I'll be there. Hopefully I see you and many others there as well.
Yeah, you won't miss my shining head, mate.
Oh, I can't wait.
Good man. Cheers, Luca.
See ya.
A massive thank you to Luca Tessadri for joining me. He only arrived back in the country on that Sunday and we spoke on the Sunday evening. So a massive thank you to him for joining me. And a well done to those GB18s boys coming away from Serbia with a bronze medal. That is it. Episode 30 is in the bank. I'd like to say a massive thank you to all of my guests, to Joe and Chris for giving up a massive part of their evening to discuss hockey. But we know they love it anyway. And to Ellie Wakeling, thank you so much for her joining me live from Korea twice, obviously, the second time we got it. And another thank you to Luca Tessadri for joining me on the podcast as well. We have got one more episode to go this season. I will be joined next week by Anthony Russell from Banners on the Wall to break down all of the teams in the NIHL 1 South, apart from Solent and Streatham, because we've done them with Joe and Chris. And we'll break down all of their seasons and look forward to next season as well as giving you all the results from the Chelmsford presentation evening. So what players won what, and anything that sort of goes down. There won't be any recording from that session. We're going to give the players and myself, of course, a night off. But we'll give you all the details of that on next week's episode. So, yeah, please do all you can with the listening and the sharing and the following and whatnot and get all of that out there. Really does help the podcast grow, and I appreciate it no ends. Honestly, it really, from the bottom of my heart, absolutely appreciate it. We are, of course, in partnership with Blades Belong on Your Feet. Search them up on the social media channels and follow them. An incredible message they're putting out, fighting knife crime with ice skating. And we are sponsored by Ivory Tower Fitness, the premier private gym and personal training studio in Colchester. You can find them on social media as well. Just search Ivory Tower Fitness. Thank you so much for listening, and I'll see you next time.
This podcast is hosted by Anchor on Spotify. It is available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and other podcast outlets. Subscribe on Spotify and Apple Podcasts to get notifications about new episodes. Follow us on social media, Instagram at Zero Pucks Given Podcast, Twitter at Zero Pucks Pod, YouTube at Zero Pucks Given, email zeropucksgivenpodcast@gmail.com. The music in this podcast is taken from Spotify and I do not own the tracks. Thanks for listening and we'll see you next time.